Praise God, let's give the Lord a big hand. So praise be for God. Come on. Let's shout praise and blessing to the Lord today. Amen. Sabi ko, let's bring and shout blessing to our God. Come on. Wala pa natin sa Lord sa umaga nito. Come on, let's give praises to the King of Kings and to the Lord of Lords. Kami ay palakpakan ng hinihingi ng Diyos. Amen. We can do better than that. Hallelujah. Come on. Praise the name of Jesus. Live out the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Let your name be praised and your faithfulness and your greatness, oh God, Lord, be made and known to your people today. Because this is what we expect of God. Amen. You know, we are so excited for today, as we always are, and we will always be. Because during that, we believe that 2020, there's a lot of things that God is going to display and manifest sa kanya pong church dito, sa Passion Church. Amen? Amen. By the way, what I'm going to start, where's Brian? Brian, I've sent him to your messenger, the message. You're gonna try to catch up with me, okay? He's a really good catcher, but unfortunately I couldn't catch him right now. Where is Brian? Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Praise God. Pagka po dumating si Brian, can you please tell me that nandito ako sa harapan? In case he's not gonna notice that I'm here. Yeah. Praise God. How's your week? Is everything okay? Yeah. Oops, have been blessed and who received a wonderful blessings from the Lord this week.
Amen.
Yeah. How about for those who have received surprises from the Lord? Wala na surprise. Okay. How about for those who have received annoyance this week?
Amen.
Come on, it's okay. It's not a sin. It's annoyance, okay? Who have received too much pain and troubles this week? Amen? Too much trouble. How about for those who are still in a state of denial that you don't want to admit that there's something that happened in the last week that you don't want to remember them anymore? Amen ba? Okay, kung wala kayo naranasan, make sure that you are still alive. If you haven't experienced anything, make sure that you are still alive. Okay, tap the shoulder of your neighbor. Are you still alive? And I believe you are still okay in the presence of God. Amen? Praise God. Praise God. Yan. Okay. You know what? I've given a teaching sa ating po mga outreaches, sa ating po mga outreaches dito sa church. Those who are from Bormont, those are Bormont, Poole area, Dorchester, and even in Bristol, we have given the a lot of faith builders, how your faith is being developed. Anybody? Have you heard about faith builders before? Amen? You know, there's a lot of faith builders, and sometimes we are trying to throw away and cast out the faith builders in your life. Amen? And sometimes when you are having difficulty facing the situation and facing the problems, sometimes we tend to pray the empowerment of God to cast them out. Amen ba? But without having realizing and without having coming to realization that those things have given by God so that your faith will be built. Amen? Sabi mo sa katabi mo, tap the shoulder of your neighbor. They are there to build your faith. Don't cast them out. Tama ba? One good example, you know, I assume that all of us in here, we do have a job. And let's be honest, you know, in the workplace, there's a lot of nice and good people. Tama ba? But equally, and equally, they're also not so nice people. And sometimes we try to pray and cast out the evil spirit in that person, saying, Lord, I'm praying, oh, the laziness and blah, 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 this person. And then you pray and you fast and nothing happened. Amen?
Amen?
Even in your family members. It might be your wife, it might be your husband. And sometimes you pray and sometimes cheekily speaking, you lay your hands to your husband. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. All you know, God has given them to you. God has given them to you so that you will know the things of God that has prepared for you. And one of the reasons for your faith to be built. Amen. Do you know there's a lot of faith builders you are not aware of? Pain is a faith builder. Illness is a faith builder in a way. Chaos is a faith builder. Restoration is a faith builder. Financial crisis is a faith builder. It depends on how you're going to look at those things before you're going to help them to the fullness of the essence why God has given them to you. Amen? Dispute between people are also can be a faith builders. Amen? I started the decade having coughs and colds with matching fever on the sideline and asthma once in a while. But I said, oh Lord, nothing can stop me from serving you. And nothing can waver my faith because I know it's just going to build my faith. So I mean, anything that will not kill you, it will strengthen you. Pag hindi ka mo'y kamamatay yan, mapapalakasan sa'yo. Amen? Kung yung asawa mo hindi ka pala papatay, pinapalakas ka niya. If your spouse is not killing you yet, the purpose of your spouse is to strengthen and to empower you simply because there's a greater things that God has in store for you is 2020. For those who believe, let's give a big praise to the Lord. Pag hindi pa tayo nag-uusapan, no? Okay, and even Apostle Paul at one point, he said, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. If I'm going to die simply because he's standing on the faith, then simply because I follow and I serve God, I would rather they die that way. Amen? Marami buhay, mukha nang patay eh. There's a lot of people, you're still alive, but spiritually speaking, you are dying. But today, we're going to renounce that, we're going to rebuke that, because the people of God, in the church of God, has been called to be alive and powerful and multiplying, and that is the design of God in every family and every church of the living God. Amen. Along the way, something happened. The faith builders that are supposed to build your faith are the things that you're trying to cast out and kick out. Amen? And then you just invite the good things and the nice things and the pleasant things of this world. I'm telling you this, the pleasant thing, it will not give you any growth at all. Walang ibibigay na panglago ang lahat ng maiinam na bagay. It is just for enjoyment. But in terms of growth, not at all. Are you with me? Anyway, that's not a topic. The thing we're going to have today is freedom. Can you remember freedom? Yeah. And then the subtitle is this. Breaking free of controlling the habits. You know what? Breaking free of controlling the habits. Can you tell me some of the habits you have, whether bad or good? I know some people hear their habit is every time they're going to sleep, there must be a pillow where their feet can be castration, you know? You know, castration? Scratch their feet on the pillow. They imported a mosquito net from the Philippines and the pillow has been wrapped around with the mosquito net and I said, what? Some people, they cannot do the Bible study and their devotions while they're sitting on the chair. There's also another pillow on the floor. Okay? If there's a Versace in the floor in the church, there's a pillow on the floor. Are you with me? There's a bad habit. Amen? Ano pa? There are some people here, your habits are wow. Let's talk about that habit. May mga habits sa'yo, madam. Sabi ko, when is your birthday? Yes, that's why. Can I give you a counter? Amen ba? What's the habit? Sometimes we have habits and ritual. There are some good habits. Amen? There are some good habits. And culture. the church. We have a culture in the church. If you are standing here on Sunday, we have the culture, we have the habits that everyone must be on the prayer and fasting. You're not allowed to stand in the front if you are not on the fasting mode. I suppose the worship team is aware of that. Amen? But we're going to talk to you all about today's not a good habits. Just for a change. The things we're going to be doing right now is for us, the things that really control us, habits that control us, but now we will control them. Amen?
Amen.
So there's one thing, that there's one habit that I would like to change this year. I don't normally do the preaching on Monday and Tuesday, no matter how hard I try to do it. My mind is not set to do the message. I would like to do it, it's either Friday, Saturday. Why? Because when I preach it, it's going to be so fresh. In a great and fresh anointing. I'm asking the Lord, is it a good habit or is it a bad habit? I'm going to ask you this thing. What is your habit? Some people, there's a bad habit. Every time you ask something, the habit is to excuse. Tell your neighbor, are you excusologist? There's a bad habit of excusologist. Okay? You know the bad thing about the excusologist? He has the problem for every solution. Amen. But a faithful person, he has a solution for every problem. So now you know who's the sociologist. Let's do this, we can do this. That's so hard. How can we make it easier? No way. Everything is hard. Bakit there are exosologies? Turn your Bible with me in Galatians chapter 1, chapter 5. Verses 1 to 3. 1, 13. 1 and then we're going to jump into 13. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. And then 13, we're going to jump into 13. Stand fast therefore in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. In verse 13, sa NIV ko naman siya binuha, you my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. Listen to this, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. God has called you not to be a slave. Tell your neighbor, you are not called to be a slave. God has called you to be taken out of the bondage and have the liberty that comes from God. But at the same time, don't use the grace of God and the love of God and the forgiveness of God to sin. You are called to be free, listen to this, free from sin, not free to sin. Are you with me? You are called to be free from sin, not to free to sin. Many people have been deceived for so many times and saying, Lord, now my pastor told me, the Bible told me that now my walk with you is not about sin because I've been forgiven. So therefore I can do and continue sinning. You are absolutely deceived by God. Because the grace of God and the salvation of God is going to make you and give you freedom to commit on further sinning. Whether you're going to hear this message or not, because the Spirit of God will tell you and will convict you and will empower you. I'm just going to re-emphasize this one. Pastor, grace naman, grace. Pastor, you told me it's all about grace. I've been saved by grace. Yes, you've been saved by grace. But when you become saved, the way you're going to deal sins will be different this time. You will have no appetite to keep on sinning. Now, kapatid, if you still have the biggest appetite to keep on sinning, I'm telling you this, go back and review your salvation before God. Can you hear anything for that? I'm not going to hurt you this time. I'm going to kill you. Your own self. Not my mind that I have, but it's because of the truth and the Spirit of God. I'm giving you warning from now on. Because this is the word of God for us today. Amen?
Amen.
Freedom and the breaking free of controlling the habits that we have. Sabi ko, there's a desperate need time yet for each individual to experience genuine freedom. We must be so desperate to have freedom. You know why? One of the reasons is this. A new relationship with God, listen to this. A new relationship with God gives us an outright assurance of salvation. But a freedom from sins and controlling habits is an ongoing and intentional decision we need to make daily. Sino sa katabi mo? This is a decision you need to make daily. God will change me. God will change me. Now, God is changing you, but you are not making a decision to change yourself. God has empowered you with the Spirit of God, but you are not using the power of God to change you. Amen? Sabi niya ba, oh, grace period, pastor, there must be grace on loving. There must be grace in loving. No, God is giving you the grace already, and that grace empowered you to overcome the sin. Are you with me? But I'm going to ask you this. What happened to you when, during the first time that you started to know God, to believe God? Amen? Grace gives us an assurance, an outright assurance of salvation. But I'm telling you this, a freedom from sins and controlling habits, you make a decision daily, daily. Tell to your neighbor, you have to make a decision daily. To control the controlling habits in your life. I'm telling you this. This is a big theology. This is a big theology. Do you know that grace and faith, there are some limits that the faith and grace can do in your life? Grace and faith are powerful words. Grace and faith are powerful weapons. Grace and faith are a powerful arsenal of every Christian that it can change. But the faith and the grace without the decisions will do nothing. Are you with me? Kung puro ka grace and faith, tapos you're doing nothing, this is your song. Gusto ko mong bumain. Hindi ko magawa. I would like to be good, but I cannot do it. Why? Because you're trying to rely on the grace and faith. Grace and faith has limit in some sense. Amen? To control the habits within you, you have to make a decision. I'm going to give you an example. Are you doing a daily inventory of your spiritual life? Lord, yesterday, I've been conquered by the habits that I've been having for so many years. What are those habits? I'm having the habits of laziness. Lord, I declare today, I will defeat laziness. Amen? After the prayer, you kiss the pillow. Amen? You've seen a nice, comfy, reclining chair. You've seen a nice telly. You've seen a nice weather. They're inviting you for you to be lazy. You know the reason why? Grace has nothing to do with that. Faith has nothing to do with that. Because God has empowered you already. All you have to do is to make the decisions now. All you have to do is to enjoy and experience the might of God so that the habits of controlling you, you will control them now. Are you with me? Am I connected to you right now? Amen? So it's not a matter of grace and faith. It's a decision. Man is handicapped and restricted to his or her potential if someone or something is in control of one's lives. God has not called us to live in prison cells, but in freedom to serve Him and to become fruitful and productive. Would you like to know some of the controlling habits right now that is so eminent and evident in the church? The prison cells in the church right now, that even the pastor will not be exempted? Would you like to know the prison cells, the spiritual prison cells, that all of us in the church might be a prison right now, and by the end of the service, I'm going to rebuke and cast out that kind of prison cells that are trying to slay you and save you. You know what are those? The prison cells that we call cell phone. You amen for that?
Amen.
I said to my wife yesterday, Mommy, I'm going to go to the EE tomorrow. While I'm going to cancel my monthly tariff of 10 pounds. So he said, Daddy, it's only 10 pounds. Huwag kang mag-worry pa, sabi ko, it's not about being corrupt. It's all about I would like to control something that controls me for so many years. I just need call and text. I'm gonna only use Wi-Fi and internet if there's a Wi-Fi connection. Why? How many hours are you spending on Messenger and Instagram and Facebook? And now you're telling me you don't need freedom from God. Mga kapatid, you need freedom from now on. That's why the faith we have to start growing. Amen? Check your mobile phone, how many hours you're spending in your mobile phone. There's an application that you can... Is that an application? It's a fake news. 3 hours. And then your devotion always late. Why? Because you're always on your mobile phone. Amen. Am I hurting you right now? Can you hear? Can you say an amen for those who've been hurt?
Amen.
Repent. Hallelujah. Amen po ba? God has not called us to live in a prison cell, but the enemy has put us in a prison cell without us knowing them. Because the prison cell that we know is the cell phone that we have. Amen po ba? Grabe, nakatingin ka, oh. Lumabon na yung mata ko sa iPad at saka sa iPhone. One of the things that I would like to control this year is YouTube. I'm getting so addicted to YouTube. Even though some of them and most of them are preaching and teaching, but it's getting so addictive that sometimes you don't have enough time for your family and for yourself. In the church, there are 3 kinds of people with regards to changes, with regards to controlling the habits. There are 3 kinds of people in the church. Number 1 is spectators. Tell your neighbor, spectators. Number 2 is anticipators. Number 3 are participators. What do you mean by that? Spectators with regards to change and controlling the habits that control us. The spectators have the desire to change. Listen to this. Spectators have the desire to change. Anticipators have the faith to change. Kaya nga nag-anticipate ka, I will change. Okay? But number 3 is a different one. Number 3 are participators have the desire, have the faith, and number 3 is the most important thing. And the action to change. And ask yourself, in which group do I belong? I have the desire to change, but I just watch the people changing. I anticipate the change and I know the change is going to happen in the church, but I don't do anything. But the participators of change are the ones who have the desire and the faith. Don't forget the other one and the actions to change. Who would like to change today? Who would like to have freedom from anything that controls you before? Come on, raise your hands. Who was admitting right now there's a kind of a prison cell that you need to be taken out from now on? Because I'm telling you this, unless you still and you remain in that prison cell, I'm telling you this, you cannot see and experience the greatness and the power of God in your life. You cannot see the miracles and the wonders of the God that God has prepared for you. I'm telling you this, you're going to be always in darkness. You're going to be always feeling low. You're going to be always a feeling of defeated because you are in the prison cell of your own desire. Well, you have an intentional desire to say, Lord, from now on, help me to discern the things that is controlling me. And today I want to speak about you to break free from the life-controlling habits. Turn. I would like you to break free from the life-controlling habits. And turn with me in the book of the 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. And I would like to end up with this. I mean, to start with this. 2 Peter 2, 9 to 19. They promised them freedom while they themselves are slaves of depravity. For people are slaves to whatever has mastered them. This is the last part. People are slaves to whatever that has mastered them. The pastor can be a slave of something. The elders can be a slave of something. The worship team can be a slave of something. Something that whatever that mastered them, meaning to say that control them, you are under the authority of those things. And unfortunately, we are slaves of many things. Amen? Isipin niyo po ito. Genesis. God has given us the authority to rule over what? Rule over any living creature in the Garden of Eden. Can you remember that? God has given you the power to manage and enjoy any vegetations in the garden. Amen? I'm gonna ask you this. Does the plan of God change? No. Tama? Hindi siya na-change. But the enemy changed them. Instead of us controlling the livestock and all the vegetations, they are now controlling us. How? Some of you here, maybe you are alcoholics. You are being controlled by grapes. Tama? Saan galing alak? Where did the wine and the alcohol came from? Are you with me? Some of you here, you are not controlled by vegetation. You are controlled by livestock. You are controlled by bacon. You are controlled by eggs, milk. You are controlled by the spirit called gluttony. You are not going to stop eating while your forehead is as hard as your tummy. Listen to this, listen to this. I'm gonna jump. In a recent survey in a discipleship journal magazine, this is in America. Recent survey in discipleship journal magazine in America, readers reported that their greater spiritual challenges came from 10 things. Listen to this, I'm not kidding. Okay? 10 bagay na kumontrol sa kanya. I'm telling you this, they are born again Christians. They are Christians. They are disciples in the church. They are not unbelievers. They are people who came to know the grace of God and receive the salvation of God. But they are still not controlling their habits. Number one, materialism. Amen? Pera, kwarta, salapi. If they're feeling ill, ang kanyang ang sagot sa kanila is therapy. Pera is money. In Tagalog, is pera. Amen? Pag may masakit, ang kailangan, therapy. Why? Because materialism. They are willing to sell their integrity. They are willing to sell their righteousness just because of money. Repent. Number two, pride. Apparently, the two biggest cruciate coalition happened in America some time ago. Do you know the reason why? There are sophisticated cruciate. There are sophisticated gadgets and technology and computer, blah, blah, blah. The reason why they have collided. Do you know the reason why? Because no one among them would like to get in the way. The other cruciate, no, I'm the right way. No, I'm the right way. Okay, come on, let's collide. Boom! It's based on pride. Even in the church, pride is one most important factor of the enemy. Husband and wife. Swallowing your pride will not kill you. But being humble is a great virtue. Swallowing your pride will not kill you. But humbleness and humility is a virtue. Number three, self-centeredness. Me, myself, and I. It's not about me. What about my feelings? Paano naman ako, pastor? It's always me, It's good if it's always you who try to understand. Food. Whenever there's a service of food, unahan-ahan, where's the plate, Do you ever ask it? Oh, visitor, you're the guest. Can you come first? Can you do it first? I'm also hungry, Pastor. Makapasok tayo, di ba? Laziness. Enter name more laziness. You know, laziness is one of the biggest distractions to the pastors, to your leaders, and to the authority. Instead of you doing them, you're asking somebody to do it for you. And you are the biggest distractions in being in the kingdom of God. Amen? Your problem 3 years ago, the same problem you have. Why? Because you're doing nothing. How many do the Bible, the devotion again? We've been teaching this for 6 years. Amen? Laziness, tell your neighbor, don't be lazy. Marami tao nagsasabi, there's a lot of people they say, and there is their slogan for those lazy people. It's better to be lazy. It's good. I will not get tired. You know, laziness is a sin. Amen?
Amen.
Sunday, what time do you wake up? If you're gonna go to your work, what time do you wake up? But I would like to ask this. Is that something that you have to repent and we have to repent to God? The spirit of laziness. Using and hiding in the virtue of grace. It's not about grace of waking up early and going to church late. I still love you. Anger and bitterness. Sexual lust. Pornography. Sorry for the young people. Too much sex is also another thing. Envy and gluttony. Is envy is all about the positions and the things of other people. Gluttony is all about the food. Number 9, lying. There's a lot of people, your habit is lying. Your attitude is lying. So you cannot live without lying. Amen? Dapat ganda rin sa lying in clinic. Lying there forever and ever. Amen? I'm just trying to diffuse the tensions of the things that the sins of the church is now committing. Not only in the pastor's church, but the whole church of the whole wide world. And number 10 is religiosity. Pastor, is there any religiosity in the church? Yes. What's the form of religiosity? If you're blessed, you're going to go to church. Full of problems, you will not attend. That's religiosity. It's your birthday, I will attend. I'm going to go for holiday, I would like to be prayed for by the pastor, I will go to the church. That is religiosity. Does it make sense? Don't ever, ever say that simply because you're in a biblical Christian church, you can be religious. You can also be religious. Why? Because you're trying to manipulate things to happen your way, and your will, and your time. And your preferences, that is religiosity. Can you hear amen for that?
Amen.
There's a desperate need for us to change and control those controlling habits. Every individual has his own cell where he is a slave. I said slave because they have mastered and controlled us. If your mobile phone is controlling you, you are a slave of your mobile phone. No, I like Eddie. Where's Eddie? He's not here. You know the mobile phone of Eddie? No, I'm telling you. I also have a mobile phone like that. I would like to go back to the simple thing. The more things get complicated, the more it controls you. Honestly, I hate mobile phones now. I would like to be honest with you guys. But I'm telling to myself, but how can I control my mobile phone and not the mobile phone controlling me? Everything you need is in here. My phone has text messages. Do you have your text messages? I can make a call. Can you make a call on your mobile phone? Surf the net. See a video, films, everything. I can cook. I can buy plane tickets. I can do everything. But sometimes those are the things that distract you because they are controlling your habits. They are controlling habits that gives no eternal reward in your life. There's a proper use of the mobile phone. Why I'm focusing on the mobile phone? Because if there's one thing that the enemy is using right now to control your habits and to control your life and to distract you from the spiritual things of life, I'm telling you this, one of them, no doubt at all, it is the mobile phone. If you're going to control your mobile phone will control you. 2 Peter 2:9. You are slave of everything that master you. Kinokontrol ka niya. Are you still there? How do we identify a controlling habit? How do we identify a controlling habit? A controlling habit is something that you find yourself doing even though it is destructive. Either physical, mentally, emotionally, relationally, or spiritually. You know it causing you chaos. You know it causing you troubles. You know it's stealing your time. Your time to pray, your time to devote your time for God. It's stealing your time to devote to your family, to your husband, to your wife. But you have no power to control and you have no power to stop them. So I'm telling you right now, you are under the spell of the controlling spirit in your life. And you have to repent from now on. I'm getting so mad with the spirit that is controlling us right now. You know, there's one thing I would like to tell you guys. One of the reasons why I went on a sabbatical, if there's one controlling spirit that I would like to kill in my life. You know what's that? The controlling spirit of materialism. When we computed our finances, there's no way we can survive. I'm telling you this. But I said to myself, Lord, I will trust you. Because I would like to kill the controlling spirit. Materialism. Let's give the Lord a big hand of praise. You know it's true. It is trying to ruin your life, but you consistently do something you wish you wouldn't do, but you find yourself doing it anyway. You know, at one point, even Apostle Paul said that. And sabi ni Apostle Paul, I'm so amazed, I'm so confused, I'm so surprised. The thing I don't want to do, that's why I can't do it. And that's the thing that I would like to start doing, I cannot do. What should I do? I'm going to ask you, did you experience the same experience of Paul? You would like to do something for God, but you cannot do it. And the things that you don't want to do, that's the thing you keep on doing. You know the reason why? Maybe you're just anticipator. Maybe you're just a spectator. From now on, don't be an spectator. Don't be an anticipator. Be a participator. Make a decision. When you go out tonight, when you start living your life, saying, Lord, I would like to overcome this. I would like to control these controlling habits in my life. But the first thing you have to do, later on, we're going to try to unpack what are the steps by steps how to control them. Are you still there?
Amen.
You must understand that many people, even good people, are bound by bad controlling habits. I'm going to say it again. You must understand that many people, even good people, are bound by bad controlling habits. Sometimes, the good people are the people hiding and doing and experiencing controlling habits in your life. Hindi mo lang nakikita. Why? Because they are really good. They are leaders. They are managers. Are you listening? No one is exempted to the controlling habits. No exemptions. Some of us visions in our minds, if we admit we had a habit that we are less than spiritual. Yung time po siya ito ganito, pag nakita nalaman ni pastor ng aking habit, I'm going to be less spiritual. No. It's a noble thing. The first thing you have to do, realize, reflect, what is the controlling habits that is not beneficial and not giving too much growth in your life from now on. Denial is not the way to deal with the problem. Tell to your neighbor, denial is not the way to deal with the problem. So there's one thing that I like about British people and the culture in this land. We are not so confrontational. Is that right? We don't want confrontation. Every time we try to confront, we say, no, let's quit on that. I'm fine, it's okay. Do you know in spiritual thing, we shouldn't be like that. In a spiritual thing, you must confront the sin and the controlling habits you have. Tama ba? Dapat confrontahin mo. Hoy, ikaw ha. One day, talk to yourself in front of the mirror. You, Benny, you're so lazy. Huh? I'm giving you a warning. Okay? I'm going to conquer you next week. Dapat pa rin. Next week pa magsisimula. Why not start now? Amen? Because I'm tired now. I'm going to conquer you next week. Amen? Denial is not the way to deal with the problems. When I was doing this one, I write down some of the controlling habits I have. Lord, I'm going to start this. Your word spoke to me first hand before the people can hear that. Be honest and look at yourself. Be honest and look at your life like Apostle Paul. Evaluate the things you find yourself doing that you hate. What are the things that you hate doing but you hate them? Realize the importance, another one, realize the importance of the identification process and then submit your inabilities to make the necessary changes. There must be an identification process. Discipleship is all about the process. Identify what are those controlling habits. Look at your neighbor. Does he look lazy? Does he look like gluttonic? Does he look like materialistic? What else? Does he look like... Ano pa iba? Does he look like bitter? Bitter Ocampo? Does he look like all of those things that is controlling them? Amen? You have to pray. For this one, you put people right now. And take a moment, sometime today or tonight, and write down the habits in your life that you want to absolutely have a victory in your life. Amen? Amen? God sees our secret sins and vices. Tell your neighbor, God sees our secret sins and vices. Do you know where and how vices started? Do you know how sins and vices started? It started with a simple uncontrolled habits. Are you with me? Sins and vices started with a simple uncontrolled habits that controls you. Amen? Alcoholic starts with a simple shot. Smoking starts with a simple sip. Gluttony starts with a simple taste. Bitterness starts with a simple tampo. What is tampo? Upset. Anger, Bitterness starts with a simple upset and a simple frustration. When those things, frustration, ano sabi ko nila? Simple things, it controls you step by step, little by little, day by day. Eventually, that habit, those habits will control your lives. Too much spending. Controlling habits, I'm going to advise you this, especially ladies and gentlemen. Hallelujah. Don't spend up something that you have never earned, or else you will be under the spell of materialism. Don't ever spend something that you have never earned yet. Meaning to say, huwag kang mangungutang as much as you can. Amen? Look at your neighbor. Mukha pa mauutang ngayon? Does he look strong to ask a million for me today? Psalms 139:3-4. Release the person beside you. 139:3-4 says that you discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. Psalm 66:18 tells us that if we cherish sin in our hearts, that God would listen to our voices and our prayers. Listen to this. If we cherish the sin in our hearts, and God would listen to our voices and our prayers. I'm telling you this. Controlling habit starts with a simple thing. There's a song in the Philippines. Hunos laklak. Nagsimula sa patikin-tiki. Nisuna. Sinubukan kong inumin. It starts with a little sip. And then the sip, another sip of gin or alcohol and everything. Until sa stand, I'm getting drunk. And the following day, I would like to ask for some more. Why? It starts with a little small sip. Are you with me? I'm telling you this. Don't ever try that might gonna indulge you to go even further and to go even better. Because this is where the addiction starts to come in. Amen? Always remember this. The enemy makes sin appear to be attractive. He shows how pleasant sin and immoral conduct can be. Satan, don't belittle the power of Satan. But at the same time, don't maximize the power that Satan can do in your life. Just look at him as he is. Don't minimize, don't maximize. Satan has the power to make the sin and controlling habits look pleasant and pleasing. Can you hear me? Si Satan kaya niyang gawin na yung kasalanan to look attractive and to look pleasant and pleasing to you. But of course, Satan will never show the tragic end of sin caused by the controlling habits in your life. Si Satan is always good on presenting the product opposite. He always tell you how to start it, but he will not tell you where you're gonna end up to. Hindi niya sasabihin kung saan ka magwawakas. Amen? You know, Satan is not like a prescription on your medicine bottles or in the cigarette warning. What the cigarette warning says? Smoking kills. Okay? Satan, when Satan offers you a controlling habit, it will not tell you, sinning will kill you. No. When Satan tempts you, it has no warning. Tell your neighbor, Satan has no warning. What awaits at the end? The Bible says, the Bible does say there's a pleasure in sin. Listen to these young people. Listen to these couples. Listen to these all the people in the church. There's a pleasure in sin, but such pleasure is only momentarily. Momentary pleasure for eternal miseries. God will chase after you. Because God loves you. Huwag ka nang matago ng kasalanan mo. Don't ever, ever hide the controlling habits. Expose your controlling habits in your life right now. Amen? Tell your neighbor, expose your controlling habits. And give it up at the footstool of the cross. Let's give the Lord a big hand of praise for that. The end result is not only pain, but separation from God on earth. Then in eternity. Spending an eternity in hell is the result of continuing in sin, influenced by the controlling habits. Life is not easy with the devil. It is the most difficult of all lives. Another one. God desire for us to confess and repent of our sins. Mga kapatid, grace and faith has nothing to do with this thing. What is the most important thing is your decision. A decision and a self-will and saying, Lord, from now on, help me. I'm making a decision. I'm making an intentional action that from now on, I will not be controlled by these habits and sins in my life anymore. I will not be controlled by these vices anymore in my life. I'm telling this, don't fight your vices on your own. Hindi mo kaya yan. You cannot conquer your vices. Amen? There's a lot of vices. The only way that you can control them is daily surrender them. So yun sa akin mo, daily surrender them. Intentionally and spiritually. Another one, God desires a blameless witness for His children. God repeatedly tells the people to be holy for He is holy. God will not give you holiness unless you desire and act for holiness. Amen? God will not give you holiness unless you desire and act for holiness. Why controlling habits are so powerful? Number one. Why controlling habits are so powerful? Number one, they slowly bind you. They slowly bind you. The controlling habit slowly bind you. Not in an abrupt change, but slowly and slowly. Parang slow cooker yan. Amen? It's not a pressure cooker, it's a slow cooker. Life controlling habits are formed at pace almost unnoticeable. Okay? Ang pace pala niya, ang rate pala niya, unnoticeable. Usually the person does not even know they have formed a habit in their life. And if someone asks, they say, I can quit at any time. This is not a problem. Darling, I can quit any time, but not now. But I can quit any time. The more they say that I can quit anytime, the more they cannot quit. Why? Because the anytime is today. Are you with me? If a person keep on saying, I can quit anytime soon, I'm telling you this, he will not quit. Because the soon is today. Tell to your neighbor, the soon is today. Not next week. Not tomorrow. Not next month. So much more than even a life after here. The change must start today. A lot of people, evangelistic concert, revival meeting, casting out demons and everything. And then after that, you cry and cry and jump and you cry to the Lord and you feel the presence of God. But unless you make a decision, they are nothing. And then the devil will tell you, it's okay for you to cry. It's okay for you to raise your hands. It's okay, it's fine. But don't change. Don't make a decision. Go again next time. Revival meeting. Go again. Listen to the pastor again. But don't change. And then, a loud voice will hear. You are being deceived. Can you hear an amen for that?
Amen.
Habits are like a cable. Each day we do something in pattern. We intertwine one thread with another. As the threads are woven together, a cable is formed. On any day, the threads we added were too small to be noticed. Listen to this. But after many threads have been woven in, we find that together they have become an unbreakable cable. So it is with habits. Daily practices over time. Listen to this. Daily practices over time become habits that are unbreakable. That is why you are under the spell of habits, because they didn't come over time. You've been doing them for years and years and years and years. One little thing, one after the other. Now you cannot break them anymore. And the only one that can break them is only the Spirit of the living God. It's through prayer and fasting, by casting out the spirit that's trying to control and enslave you. How did they start? It's like a thread, one unnoticeable thread that intertwined together little by little, day by day. It didn't happen overnight. And so much more, you cannot overcome them overnight, but you can only overcome them by the power and the might of the Holy Spirit. Bad habits are like comfortable beds. Easy to get into, but hard to get out. It's got a nice bed here. Our bed is not so nice. That's why I don't sleep much. That's the reason why we're not buying the best beds yet. Why? Where's Pastor? Still on bed. Amen? We got a good, nice bed, but not the most comfortable bed in the whole wide world. You know the reason why? Because bad habits are comfortable beds. Easy to get into, but hard to get out. Amen? It takes time. After time, smoke after smoke, drinks after drinks, before the body becomes dependent upon liquor and nicotine and everything, and food and everything. This is for everyone. This is not only for some. This is the reason a habit is so powerful. You know why? Because habits, it is so very subtle. It creeps in without you noticing them. Are you with me? What are the habits? I'm not going to go to the church. Only one Sunday. After one Sunday, what's going to happen next? The two will become? The one will become two, and the two will become three. After three? How did you know? And after four? Become five. Until you realize you're only getting out of fellowship. Only to realize that the presence of the Almighty God is no longer, and the favor is no longer upon you. Why? Because of the habits. Lastly, not only they do slowly bind you, but they break your will. Listen to this. This is the most important thing. Not only do they slowly bind, they break your will. Habits will break your will. Once you have allowed, listen to this. Once you have allowed the habit to control you, the Bible says the habit is your master. The habit breaks down to the point where you don't even try to resist because you feel like you cannot break free. The attitude becomes, ito na sinasabi mo, why should I try? I always go back to doing it again anyway. A habit will break your will to fight. A habit will break your will to fight. A habit will break your will to change. A habit will break your will to fight and change for the better. Why? Because you rationalize, I cannot do it anymore. Because this is my habit. Right? I would like to end up in prayer. I would like you to show, are you connected to Messenger? I would like you to show, before you're going to show that, who is more stronger? A 1 meter stick or an elephant? Logically speaking. Are you sure? How about if I'm going to tell you a 1 meter stick is more powerful than the elephant? Are you going to believe me? It takes process before a 1 meter stick becomes more powerful and can command the elephant. When I was watching this last night, I was almost crying. Lord, this is the church. The church is so big. The church is like an elephant. You called us to be a giant. You called us to be huge. You told us to be humongous. But we are being controlled by 1 meter stick. But 1 meter stick took a while before it controls the giant, before it controls the elephant. And I would like you to have a look on this one. Anak, yung una-una, sunod yung dorin mo yan. Who has been to the circus? Sino nakaka-African na elephant dancing, jumping, singing, acrobating, blah, blah, blah. You know what? There are the process why the 1 meter stick can control the elephant. Yung sumunod pang anak, yung hanga-hanga, yung wordings niya. I think I'm going to end up with this. I think we have too much. But I would like you to show this thing first. Ayan na. Nababasa niyo ba? Can you read that? Steps to training and breaking an elephant. Before an elephant becomes a slave, there is some kind of a process that took place. And I would like you to know and see the big things about this thing. The first thing that happened to that elephant, from the moment that he was born, even though he was destined to be powerful, even though he was destined to be powerful, to be big, to be giant, but something along the way controlled his power to become one. And the first thing that happened is that the training and breaking an elephant, the step one is to acquire a baby elephant. The first thing that the enemy is trying to take from you, the first step, Brian, is that my one? Step one is acquire a baby elephant. From the moment the baby elephant was born, there will be no chance that the baby elephant will be with the mother. Itaytay niya kagad ito. And this is what happened. By force, the people who would like to train their elephant will take the elephant by force. Did you see that? They are being dapusized. Tied up. All four legs. Okay? That is the first one. Acquire a baby elephant in a very brutal force. Step two, take the babies away from the mother. Break the baby's elephant spirit. He doesn't want to be dependent on the spirit of the mother. Because when he's dependent on the spirit of the mother, he will take the spirit of his mother to fight. That's why even on the first day when the baby elephant was born, he's been taken away. So that there will be no more spirit that he will take from his mother. Just like you and me. The enemy is trying to take your spirit by taking and distracting you so that you will not get the spirit of God in you. Because when you know you've got the spirit of God in you, you know you can fight the enemy. Amen. Oh Lord, the elephant is the church. We've been born again. We have the power. We have the might. But we are powerless. Why? Because from the very first moment, the spirit of the living God has been taken away from us. Number three. And this is the picture when the baby elephant has been taken away. Hallelujah. No, that's not elephant. That's mountain. Soon, the elephant will go there. Amen? Hallelujah. Take the babies away from their mother and then break the baby's elephant spirit. Mga kapatid, the enemy is trying to break your spirit so that you will not fight the enemy. That you will have no power to go against the will of the enemy in your life. But I'm telling you, the spirit that God is giving you is more powerful than the spirit that is in the world. Amen? And then number three. Are you okay there? Number three. Tie up, confine, and isolate the baby. They will have no chance to be in the presence of the mother. When I was trying to have a look, I would like to be honest with you guys, I don't love animals that much. But when I've seen the video last night, I've seen it in the YouTube. I tried to spiritualize The elephant is the chief. The elephant is you. Many things is controlling you right now. This is one in your spirit. Why? Because your spirit has been broken down. Because your relationship has been ruined and been stuck and been blocked. Just like the elephant. You've been tied up and confined, and you've been isolated in the presence of God. And then number four, the trainer of the elephant, they force the baby elephant to do the circus tricks. It's not nature of the elephant to dance. It's not the nature of the elephant to sit on a chair. It's not the nature of the elephant to do some kind of a circus thing. But I'm gonna ask you this thing, why the elephant are doing that? Because they are being controlled by their master. They are being controlled by just one meter stick who threatened them from the moment they were born. Tinakot siya ng one meter stick. Every time they're gonna commit mistake, they're gonna be hit by electric shock, by a meter stick. They're gonna do some punishment. They're going to tie up all the legs. They're gonna try to spread them one after the other. When I was watching this, I'm telling you this, I started to love animals. Because the way I see them, they apply that brutal force. When I was reading this, the one who exposed these things is one of the trainers of the elephant in the circus. It is documentary. And at the end, it says, what are the things you need to train an elephant? Electric shock, meter stick, and this is what is most surprising, a cold heart, and a brutal force. A cold heart and a brutal force. Why? Because the trainer inflict a habit that the elephant cannot refuse. He inflict the habit that the elephant cannot refuse. Even though the elephant is displayed to be strong and mighty and big, he is powerless. Have got it. Even though you're Christians, if there are habits that is controlling you, I'm telling you this, you are like elephant. You are big. You are destined to be big. You are destined to be the one of the kings of the jungle. But you become so powerless by a simple rod. The rod can command you where you have to go, what you have to do. And in this church from now on, I would like to pray, God is going to bring the might and the power that the enemy has stolen you. You are an elephant, but your might and power and your size has been taken and belittled by your trainer. But tonight and this afternoon, God is going to bring the might. The might to fight against the bad habits that controls you from the moment you were born. Who would like to experience that right now? For those who would like to experience, I would like you to stand up right now. A message to the Lord, but I would like to end up with that. Hallelujah, Jesus.